Double Alert Tour on ESPN is being brought. It's 21-year-old Stacy Ryder of La Habra, California. Her opponent in the opening test is 23-time champion Lisa Wagner, looking for her second straight victory. Beginning from the middle of the stack this evening, it's 22-year-old Leanne Barrett, shooting for her third title here in 1989. Qualifying in the runner-up position here this evening, it's 10-time champion Nikki Giannoulias, while 27-year-old Alita Sill, who averaged 222 for 42 games this week, will need to win just one game in order to collect $7,000 and her 16th career championship. And welcome to beautiful Country Club Lange in Baltimore, Maryland, for the championship round finals of the $40,000 Hammer Eastern Open. Hi, everyone. I'm Denny Schreiner, and welcome to Baltimore, Maryland. And of the top four contestants on the telecast this evening, they have already accrued 55 national titles. So a very talented crew tonight. Leila Wagner working with me once again, finished a solid 15th this week. And Leila, the interesting note about the top five here this evening is the fact that all five qualified in the top 24 a year ago.
Well, Denny, that's really not unusual. Certain bowling centers have certain characteristics that the players really look forward to coming to the next year. They get enthusiastic about it. They have confidence coming into the center. And that's what happened here in this particular center.
When you take a look at the top seed position on the Pro Tour, you have to win when you get the opportunity to lead an event. And no player has done a better job of that on the LPBT Tour than our top seed this evening, Alita Sill. She is 8 of 14 from the top seed position. And why has she fared so well?
Well, that is very unusual. Normally, it's 30% that the players win from that top seed position. Alita is well over 60%. I had an opportunity to speak with her earlier this evening. She mentioned that, hey, there's just not much pressure on me from that number one position. I can't finish any lower than second, and I can concentrate better on a one-game match versus coming up through the field.
She had to bottle that and sell it to the rest of the tour, because that's what you have to do, win from the top seed position. Let's talk now about Lisa Wagner. She won a week ago, and of course, three other times in her illustrious career, she has won back-to-back championships. Can she do it again tonight?
Well, if any player can do it, it is Lisa Wagner. However, she's got three very talented players to go through this evening in order to do it. I guess we'll just have to wait and see.
And if you haven't yet had the opportunity to watch Stacy Ryder perform, a young player from the West Coast, you're in for a very special treat. She's a very aggressive player, throws plenty of strikes, and she's got her eyes set right now on Lisa Wagner, of course. That's her first opponent in match number one here from Country Club Lanes in Baltimore, Maryland. We'll be right back with the LPBT on ESPN. The championship round final of the $40,000 Hammer Eastern Open. Stacy Ryder on your right, Lisa Wagner to the left, and Stacy opens up the championship round by starting on the left-hand lane. The championship pair this week, 25 and 26.
Well, you really hit the nail on the head when you mentioned this player as an aggressive player. That's just exactly what she is.
Right out of the gate, throws a strike, and she obviously, too, has the biggest smile on the floor when she strikes.
She's really a fun player, likes to have a good time, goes out there, I think, half the time what knocks down the pins is that aggressiveness and the fun that she's having.
Really enjoys herself. She's got her hands full this evening, taking on a Hall of Famer in Lisa Wagner. Lisa winning last week, going with a little harder equipment, tries to keep it in the track and in the pocket, and she ends up with a split in the opening frame.
I think we're going to see a little bit of a ball speed problem here with Lisa, Denny. She was having a little problem with the approaches earlier. In order to get her ball speed, she does use the whole approach. She's having problems where her feet are sliding out from under her. So if she can't get that ball speed, as you can see there, the results, the ball hitting a little too much.
Sure, it changes your entire game when you can't get the traction.
Here we can take a look. Now, when she pushes away in that fifth, with the five-step approach, her second foot actually goes out from under her. She has a nice game here. You can see the top of her positioning in her wrist. She gets through, knee bend, but she's hesitant, and she's not able to keep that speed up.
Of course, when you're uncertain about the footing, obviously, does create some problems for you mentally. She'll have to just kind of grind it out, gets this one out of the lane a little further and leaves the soft seven pin. So right now, Lisa Wagner not only fighting the approaches, but also a talented right-hander from La Habra, California.
As you can see there, she's wiping off her shoe.
I watched her during the practice session. She started with the normal pair of shoes, the sliding shoe that she used throughout the week, and just took that off and tossed it into the bag and brought out another one. So many of the professionals utilize
more than one pair of shoes as they travel across the country.
Oh, they do, and we do hit synthetic conditions three or four times in a year, and they seem to really uphold the condition nicely. However, the approaches have a tendency to be somewhat of a problem, whether it be slippery or sticky, in almost every synthetic center that we go to. So it's just something that the girls overcome with changing shoes.
And many of the problems created by the humidity based on what the weather. And, of course, we've had dramatic changes here in the Baltimore area over the last couple of weeks. Going for the double is Ryder and doesn't get it, but that has a lot to do with the approaches.
Exactly. The humidity is such a big factor in the Florida areas. You see it even more so. Up here we've had a lot of humidity, and that's exactly one of the reasons.
Well, for those of you who are watching Stacy Ryder for the first time here this evening, we know what her talent is already this week. She's in match play defeated Alita Sill, Nikki Giannoulias, Leanne Barrett, and Lisa Wagner. You don't beat those four unless you make good shots. And I'm going to have to eat my words there because she blows the four pin.
I'm not sure if it's nerves. She says she felt a little bit of butterflies this evening. Now, Stacy doesn't have a lot of knee down. Now, this is the second band, the ball. As you can see, we're missing the four pin. The ball actually just breaks away at the last minute. Oh, just by an eyelash.
Mm-hmm. Not by much. So she'll have to bounce back. Aggressive shot and she strikes, but against the player of Lisa Wagner's caliber, let's see if the mental mistake comes back to haunt her. This is a one pin match. Lisa averaging 221 for the week, averaged 221 on the television pair. Scores were moderate to high on lanes 25 and 26. Better speed, but this one goes past the pocket, and another split opens up here in the third.
The conditioning we used this week, Denny, 33 feet of oil, a little bit of heavier oil in the center of the lane, actually crowned out to the outside part of the lane. So if the players miss their target inside, we actually see the ball skate a little too long. It doesn't make it back. If you hit the dry area a little quick, it hooks early.
Big break early. Gets in a run. Oh, what a shot for Lisa Wagner, who tears it up in the third.
I think she surprised herself by her reaction here, but just a superb attempt at this, and more so attempt to pick up. Watch the two-pin just right off the wall. And you can see her taking a little bit more easy than normally with Lisa's footwork. She's usually just up there firing away, and you'd see where that was really tentative.
Yeah, you've got to throw your timing off a little, but she makes the necessary adjustment. Comes back with a strike in the fourth. So Lisa Wagner, the great competitor that she is, bounces back from adversity. She trails by two, but she's on a survey this week. A viewer profile, we're very anxious to find out just what types of folks are watching the LPBT Tour on ESPN. And so we have a number of different questions that we'd like to ask this week. You can see them on the screen. Perhaps first and foremost, when did you start bowling? And when does your spouse bowl? And there's the number, 1-900-446-ESPN. And every 50th caller, of course, will be receiving that 10th anniversary poster. It's 95 cents per minute, and we'll give you the results next week. We'll get a real good feel for what types of folks are watching the Ladies Pro Bowlers Tour on ESPN.
Stacy Ryder looking for a double.
A little soft 10 provided that time, and after missing the four pin in the second, a double there would have cured that problem.
Actually, a good adjustment off the four pin, the soft 10 or the half 10, trying to delay the entry of the ball into the pocket just a little bit. Usually when the ball leaves the four pin, it's sitting a little too high. In this case, it just didn't break enough.
Went to the polished equipment to try and throw the ball a little straighter, and it's still hooked, so Stacy, when she strikes, is fine. The nine-pin spares are providing her with problems here this evening.
Now, the players, once again, have had a little bit of problem going for the 10-pin and sticking. Here it looks like she really pulled the ball, and it just didn't slide enough. It hooked away from the 10.
Well, we mentioned She does throw lots of strikes, and if she continues to miss the spare, she's going to beat Lisa Lang. This is in her good lane. One more time, 3-3 on the left-hand lane.
Glad you said that about her good lane. She was saying that that's why she felt so comfortable in the mixed doubles event. She only had to bowl on one lane.
That's right. She finished third in that Gold Rush doubles with her partner Mike Tucker just 3 weeks ago on ESPN. Highest finish singles-wise this year was sixth in South Bend. Looking for the double. And excellent shot and leaves a solid 10.
The 6-pin just ringing around the 10-pin that time, Danny.
Amazing about this young lady. This is her 100th match game on national television, her 64th, I think that's 60th appearance.
A lot of television time.
Get a tan with that much time. Well, she sticks a little bit as well, and safe, Lisa Wagner says. I'll take the 10-pin spare. She leads by 10 at the midway stage here. Of course, next in line, talented Leanne Barrett. Nikki Giannoulias qualifies number 2. And our top seed this week, 27-year-old Alita Sill from Dearborn, Michigan.
Well, Lisa Wagner has always liked bowling here at Country Club Lane. She finished second last year, lost to Jeannie Maiden in the title match, 201 to Jeannie's 223. So she is the only one of our top 5 finalists who did make the television show last year.
Qualified in the number 3 position and won a couple of matches. Leaves the solid 4 there.
This is her release on that shot. She was able to stay down pretty well there at the line. Now she's like, oh no. I think she realized that ball was going to hook a little high.
Mm-hmm. Well, for a player like Lisa, she's generating velocity, too, and now that she has to slow the approach down, the ball speed's going to change.
And you have to be able to adjust your line for that.
Mm-hmm. And your equipment.
Mm-hmm.
Stacy had some brand-new equipment drilled up this afternoon in preparation for the television finals here this evening. Said she wanted a ball that hooked a little more. Let's see if this one does.
Finally carrying off 10. Touches the double there and puts her up by 1-10. A very crucial strike right there in the 6th frame by Stacy Ryder.
Well, you don't go 21-3 and tie an LPBT record in match play unless you've thrown some clutch shots throughout the week. The amazing thing is, you look at the numbers for these two ladies, Lisa Wagner out-averaged Stacy Ryder by 7 pins a game.
Well, we've mentioned it many times before, Denny, that those 30 pins that are given for each match game won, now the players bowl 24 match games, just add up to so many pins. And in this case, Stacy with 21 matches, it really got her to the show, she said. But I told her, you had to throw the ball.
Amazing how those close matches, though. She won a number of them throughout the match play portion. That went through the nose, though. Barely escaped leaving the baby split.
I think this was an exact shot of what she was talking about to me. What she does, she gets a little over-aggressive, really pulled that ball over a target.
And she'll smile now because that's the first spare that she's made here in the championship round. We'll put the hammer down here this week and capture the hammer Eastern Open, $7,000 for first. And there you see the rest of the prize money on down the line. Beautiful plaque there.
A beautiful plaque. And Hammer, such a great sponsor of the women's tour over the years. Dennis Baldwin having the beautiful Country Club Lanes here. Just a gorgeous center in the Baltimore area.
They've done a marvelous job. And, of course, the chairman of the board, Earl Widman, coming back from that hip surgery down south in Daytona. We want to say hello to Earl and wish him a speedy recovery. And as tough a guy as he is, he'll be back and at him here in no time flat. But he has had some problem with some reconstructive hip surgery. We all wish him well and hope that he's back on his feet here in no time.
Have a shot at Lisa's last ball right here. Almost didn't get up to the head pin, but she got away with it, leaving only the 2-pin.
Well, the right-hand lane has been the mystery thus far, really, for both players. We've had only one double in this match. That came in the 6th frame, provided by Stacy Ryder. And you see a 1-pin match. Had Stacy made both of those one-pin spares, right now she'd be 23, 24 pins ahead. So you just can't afford to give away those one-pin spares.
No, you can't. Not any time in the tournament. You really want to stay tough in your spare shooting from the first game of qualifying all the way through the television show.
Lisa Wagner, who finished high up in this tournament a year ago, trying to come back and win match number one. Solid shot on lane 25, so he does pick up a strike in the eighth.
A lot more ball speed that time, Denny. That ball actually held the line. A lot more velocity when it hit the pin.
She's had the soft 10 a couple of times on the right-hand lane. Right-hand lane looks maybe a little tighter, huh, Lee Island?
Yes, it appears to be that way. Lisa's come up light a couple times. Stacy with the two soft 10s.
And for those of you who haven't yet noticed it, my partner's suffering with a bit of the virus and the cold and hasn't felt too well the last couple of days, and she's trying to hang tough here this evening.
Had a great couple days, Dave.
Oh, boy. Yeah, you finished 15th, but that had to be a struggle. When you don't feel well, it's tough to compete. So. But she's taking next week off, going to get a little rest, and of course, she's off bowling, but she'll be there for the telecast in Hammond, Indiana next week. So a spare again now up in the eighth, and this one's tightened up considerably now as we head into the latter stages.
And a big smile from Stacy after she picked up that 10-pin, and a great big applause.
Now, of course, Lisa, with the advantage, she could shoot 214 if she takes it off the sheet. If Stacy strikes out, it's 204. This is a key shot for Stacy Ryder here in the ninth. Made a good one and ends up with the four pin. So Lisa Wagner, normally when she gets a chance to put the vice grip on you, takes advantage. We'll have to wait and see what she comes up with in the night.
A real good professional shot there by Stacy. She has to be happy with that shot. Ball just breaking a little hard, leaving that darn old four pin is, I'd like to say.
Well, I think Stacy basically only missed the pocket on one shot. So once you see through the nose.
Actually, that was a very key shot, too. She was on a double, and had she struck there,
yep,
would have kept it going.
And
so
she broke down the baby split in the seventh and ended up with just a three pin. Lisa takes a good look at the scoreboard, realizes if she strikes right here, she's well on her way to advancing into game number two. In the tough lane. That was about as good a shot as you could throw, and you've seen now she's made the necessary adjustment.
Well, Lisa, last time leaving that two pin, she made the adjustment. Low angle there, actually falling off balance after she threw it. Lisa got off her hand good and frozen rope.
Ball comes by like an Indy 500 race car. Did you notice that?
Well, that's their hobby, so.
Beautiful camera work that time. Good look at the strike shot. Now, will she give this enough room? Nine count. But with a spare here and a strike, she can do no worse than tie.
Stacy closing her eyes, knowing that she still has an opportunity to continue and talking to herself a little bit.
Yeah, if Lisa spares and strikes, she shoots 193, and if Stacy strikes out, she'll shoot the same. Stranger things have happened. Right now, Stacy's hoping for any kind of an opportunity. If Lisa doesn't strike, now she can step up in the 10th and win.
And knowing that Lisa could have walked up and shut her out, I'm sure Stacy's at least happy with the opportunity to still stay in this.
Well, fortunate, I would say, to end up with nine. So three strikes and Stacy Ryder is a winner. 2-9, and we'll go to sudden death. I guess you have to take it one shot at a time, though, right?
You do. In lane 26, she's left two soft 10s in her last two attempts, so see if she overcomes those.
She's She's a player that likes the opportunity to challenge herself, and right now she's presented with that scenario. Really ripped the finger holes out.
Perfect shot. And that's the aggressiveness right there that we talked about earlier on in the match. And I liked the look on her face after she threw it. A lot of loft, a lot of fingers and revolutions on this ball. It hit the pocket, and all 10 were gone. Now, the reaction is what I really liked.
Growling at him a little bit. Needs one more to get to the pin. Oh, my. What a beautiful display of clutch bowling. And Lisa can do nothing now but hope for a 9-10. Every player, I think, dreams of striking out to win on television.
You bet. And Stacy right now just trying to calm herself down, says, hey, don't get too aggressive. I've done that before, too. Just take it easy and do just what she did the last two shots.
Disappointed, has given the fans something to ooh and ah about, and Lisa Wagner will advance by the skin of her teeth, 192 to 190 here in Baltimore, Maryland. Coming up, Lisa Wagner will sigh. Art Beattie, and no relation to Warren, I'm told, the general manager here at Country Club Lanes, the big fella, good guy, handing over the plaque and the $2,000 first place check to the Pro-Am winner, Cindy Ray, a marvelous pro-am, better than 800 entries here this week, bowling with the ladies on the Ladies Pro Bowlers Tour. So fun for one and all, and now it's back to serious business as of sorts. Leanne Barrett with seven. That's right, seven titles already in just 3 years as a professional is next in line for Lisa Wagner. Leanne finishing up on her practice shots here on the championship round pair of 25 and 26. And without question, this young lady has a superstar written all over her as she wraps up practice shots here on the championship pair. And now it's Lisa and Leanne. The winner, of course, to take on Nikki Giannulli as Alita Sill remains the top seed here this week. After a clutch 192 to 190 victory over Stacy Ryder in game number one, Lisa starts on lane 25 here in match number two.
I think Lisa's getting more and more comfortable with the pair and the approach is getting. That ball had a lot of ball speed on it, cooking a little high on her.
Leaves the 3-6-10.
Lisa Wagner, 28 years of age.
Asked her if her husband Kent was here this week, and she said, nah, he's down south playing with the race cars. He'll be out next week. Of course, he'll be cranking it up and getting ready to head on the PBA Fall Tour within the next 3 weeks. So Lisa disposes of the 3-6-10.
And you mentioned superstar, Denny. This lady definitely has it all written all over her because the attitude, the mental game that Leanne Barrett has is just so strong besides her physical game. Her physical release and her bowling ball is unbelievable.
Accurate and with great power. And that's a nice combination to have and leaves a solid four pin here in the first.
Here you can see her stance. She starts off actually facing to the right, a five-step approach, starting the ball very low. Look at the knee bend here. Great follow-through.
Tremendous extension, really. There's an ability to get the ball down the lane. And I tell you, when it goes, it's rolling, too. That's spinning, it's rolling.
Leanne finds that when she has problems is if she doesn't have that area to the right because she is very open and she doesn't have any area to the right. We saw a little bit earlier this year in Delaware that you had to play very tight. Leanne was unable really to do that, so she likes the condition where she can go right with the ball.
You mentioned open, of course. We're talking about her shoulders being a little open at the line and basically her hips as well to try and create a little shot to the right, as they say.
She likes to cross boards.
She does pretty well, too. Leaves another solid four. So
Well, consistency is what it is, Denny, and we've seen her many times on television just come up and strike after strike after strike and really string them on television and throughout the tournament. And I think that's, you know, a big key. She shot 300 earlier this week. And if you can do that consistently, that's what makes you a great player.
Yeah. She shot the first 300 here this week. And as a matter of fact, if you look back history-wise, she shot the first 300 in this bowling center last year during this tournament. So she's a lady of first, you might say. A couple of spare ups on the four pins, and Lisa Wagner goes to work now in the second.
And Lisa Wagner's progress through game one. She is now up on lane 26.
There you can see the thumb went down quickly there, and she pulled that shot. She's still, I think, struggling a bit on the right-hand lane.
I think so. She's not getting the reaction that she wants or wants to see. Ball going light or high, nothing in between.
Almost seems like she does not want to trust it right because she's afraid it's not going to come back, so she's kind of fitting the ball a little bit. And when you get into that situation, it's just not turning over or rolling. You don't create any area at all for yourself. Lisa with 23 career titles. Of course, the first woman ever to surpass the $100,000 mark in a single season.
Just having a superb year last year. Now this year she doesn't feel as well, yet she's over the $40,000 mark, $50,000 mark after last week's win. So, you know, we mentioned it, that it's too bad. That's a bad year for her. That's a great year for some players.
When you go for 105 the year before and you're like 56 with six tournaments left, you kind of feel like you're behind schedule. But overall, with her career earnings of $359,319, she, of course, tops the LPDT list in that department.
In the running for Bowler of the Decade, along with Alita Phil and Lori Nichols. We'll have to wait and see the results of that voting.
Sure. One of the key questions being raised by our new magazine format show, Bowling World, which will debut next Monday, October 2nd on ESPN, beginning at 3:30 Eastern Time. And we'll be asking the fans to vote on the male and female bowler of the 80s. Interesting look at some of the top personnel on the LPDT and PDA Tour. A strike in the third for Leanne Barrett.
Leanne Barrett with a few wrist problems earlier this year in the fall, or in the spring, and also the summer. She was having some tendonitis problems. I think she's overcome that with a little bit of the break in the summer. Looking for the double.
Lead here in game number two of the $40,000 Hammer Eastern Open. We'll be back with more after this. We're away in the fourth frame. Lisa Wagner left the 2-4-5 and spared it up. Leanne Barrett right now in the lead in game number two.
Well, on lane 26, she did get up, trusted it, and left a bucket. So we had seen her before trying to hit the ball, and she gave it the room and it didn't come back.
Now the key is maybe she might change equipment on the right-hand lane. We'll have to wait and see. A little more speed, accurate shot, and she leaves the half 10 on lane 25. And you can see she's fighting the approaches.
Yeah, she's not real happy with her release and getting out of the ball. And so much of that depends on footwork with a woman bowler, whereas a man can actually overpower the ball. Women rely on their footwork in order to get their ball speed. And some players that have a longer slide, a longer approach, this affects more than other players.
Kind of drops it in there and pairs up the thumbs in. I mentioned Leanne, just 22 years of age. Basically grew up on the West Coast. I was kidding a little earlier today about some of the other very talented young players out there. I said, boy, you know, this Linda Norrie's an excellent player, and so is Kim Terrell. She made the show last week, and she winked, and she said, you know, I bowled with those girls in junior league all the way up until I was about 15, so I'm very familiar with their talent. X marks the spot in the fifth, and Barrett right now is cranking it up.
have to look at Leanne's style from behind as you can see how her arm swing actually wraps around her body. Left and then to the right. That's where you can see that open shoulder and open to her target.
Almost the old figure eight look. Remember Billy Whaley used to throw it that way? Several of the older players used to wrap it a little bit as long as you got it back to the right spot. Strikes again, she's got four in a row, and if she's got a little area to the right, that's normally when Leanne is most effective, and obviously she has that here tonight.
You know, it's the figure eight, Denny, that when you went, you would go in and then go out and come back in. Leanne's reversed. An S-curve, but reversed.
But if you watch it at the very bottom of the swing, it's dead square when she gets to the line.
And that's the key.
Yeah. If you look at Scott Devers on the men's tour, same thing happens with him. And this square swing is about as good as you can get for Lisa Wagner. It's mocking the slippery approaches a little bit.
Well, knowing she can't get the velocity here, you can just see the amount of revolutions on her ball. Now, this is Lisa's backswing. Look how straight it is, just straight up and straight back.
And I think that's why she probably is the best player going right now. Got to be the most accurate. She combines power with accuracy.
Not getting into too much trouble on various conditions. She's able to stay and fly, and that's why Lori Nichols, over all the years, has been able to just stay right up there all the time because of that straight backswing and not getting into trouble.
How many boards difference belly-wise in the first 15 feet between her and Leanne, would you say?
Well, Leanne's setting the ball at 12, going all the way out to 7,
sure.
6. And Lisa's probably having about three board belly.
At the most.
At the most.
And that's when she's really trying to arc the ball. Right now, buried in the lead, Lisa Wagner trying to gain some momentum and throws a beautiful shot in the 7. So, we'll be back with the conclusion of match number 2 here from Country Club Lanes. Leanne Barrett leads by a bundle. Spare up there now leads by 36. However, Lisa Wagner is still on a strike and still could shoot a game in the 230s if she goes out the window.
Lisa's still having problems on the right lane, so I sort of like Leanne's chances at this point.
Leanne's probably figuring exactly the same. She knows what the problems are right now, so she can just post the score, as they say. She'll probably move on to the semifinal game. Boy, that ball hits hard, doesn't it?
It sure does. 88 Bowler's Journal All-American. In 87, she was the Bowling Digest Rookie of the Year. So, such a young age of 22, she's put together a lot of nice statistics.
And at the tender age of 28, Lisa Wagner already has 23 victories, so another outstanding career. More speed, different ball. Basically the same reaction, not a strike on lane 26. And that was the key shot for Lisa.
Well, it was. And you mentioned that the next change would probably be a ball change, and that's exactly what she did. She was not getting a reaction off the ball she was using. She was either getting into the dry area, was hooking too much, into the oily area, as we say, was not hooking enough. So she went to a softer shell bowling ball. It still hooked. And she came back, she said, I got it. Doesn't matter that it did fall in the channel first and the ball did not go in the channel and hit the pin and still count. So I think Lisa's
watch out for the camera here. Oh, my.
Steamer. Oh, goodness. Came right to it. Well, Lisa did stick on that, as you can.
That almost looked like the thrill cam right there. Of course, our Baltimore crew risking life and limb to try and stay with that shot. And Lisa is still at this point trying to gather herself. But I think the key about her attitude is that she was able to laugh off the missed spare and say, hey, it's not my week. I'm going to finish fourth, and I'll take my chances next week in Indiana.
That's exactly right. You know, she won last week, and she felt fortunate how her career went last year. She said, you know, things just went my way, and right now things are going Robin Romeo's way, actually. She's the player, really, to beat this year.
Career match play record of 62-37-1 in her national television career. Those are Hall of Fame numbers right across the board. Just trying to finish up without getting hurt at this point. And there you can see the disappointment and yet the acceptance, the reality of the situation, because she's run into a buzzsaw on Leanne Barrett. Leanne, if she strikes out the ninth and the tenth, shoots 258. Those are big-time numbers.
Leanne's high scheme on television is 279. She did roll that against Alita Seale in the AMF Virginia Classic a year ago, and these two will be matched up again if she beats Nikki Giannullis.
That's right.
We may have a rematch of that particular event. We'll have to wait and see.
So game number two now into the record books, officially over as far as Lisa Wagner is concerned. Lisa will finish up with $2,000 to her credit, so she's just a fraction under $60,000 now on the year. Meanwhile, Leanne Barrett will continue to climb the ladder and take on Nikki Giannullis, who is next in line.
Lisa's mother, Emma Jean Rathgeber, and also her mother-in-law, Leah Wagner, are in the audience this evening and have been here throughout the week cheering Lisa on.
We're hoping for perhaps a little better result, but I know they're very, very proud of that young lady. A bomb in the 10th by Leanne Barrett. He has a possible 238. Has the ability to come into the championship round and throw strikes and strings of strikes, Leanna Wagner, which is really the key.
It is. Her level of concentration, as I mentioned, is so strong, Denny. I just don't think she really lets too many things bother her, get in her thought pattern.
Led this tournament for a while this week and had it slip away and basically said, well, I'll just have to start from number three position and see what I can muster.
It was very tight in about the fourth game of the first round in the finals. All five positions, there was only 27 pins separating all five, and it was a very, very close tournament all the way around. I dropped four spots just in the last game, so all the spots themselves could have changed there in the last game.
You needed a reach for the parachute there. Well, there's the handshake. So as Lisa Wagner finishes out game number two, Leanne Barrett will look to the future. And Nikki Giannullis, who is next in line here at Country Club Lanes in Baltimore, Maryland. Terrell, a championship round finalist a week ago, finishing up in the number six position. Carol Giannotti had to come in as the alternate.
We'll talk a little bit about that after we finish the top 24 finishers.
Cheryl Daniels with an outside shot at the telecast. Robin Romeo adds another $1,100 in that chase for the $100,000 mark.
Anne-Marie Pike making a tremendous surge, shooting 300 over last night to make it up to 11th.
Leila Wagner putting $980 back into the bank account as Mary Martha Trenelier, who was in the top five most of the week, finished up 16th.
Our tournament qualifier, Mary Martha. And also Betty Morris, their 19th position.
Defending champion Jeannie Maiden qualifies 22.
And once again, Judy Sutar picking up that 24th spot. And Donna Adamek taking over the alternate position.
Karen Ellingsworth, former U.S. Open champion in 26. Those are the rest of the ladies that finished up with paychecks here at Country Club Lanes in Baltimore, Maryland this week. As we turn from bowling to the PGA Tour, complete four-round coverage coming up from Tallahassee, Florida. Let's hope things have dried out a little bit down in the Sunshine State. Thursday through Sunday, live 4 p.m. Eastern Time, 1 p.m. Pacific Time. The PGA Tour, live on ESPN. Size of the field, the century mark this week, 100, averaged to cash, a little fraction better than 202, and to make the telecast, 213 this week.
Good scoring condition, as we mentioned. You really have to be on top of your game.
Next week, the $45,000 Brunswick Open, live from Olympia Lanes in Hammond, Indiana, 10 o'clock p.m. Eastern Time, live on ESPN. Our first trip to Hammond, Indiana, and I'm told it's located about 60 minutes from O'Hare Airport in Chicago. As Nikki Giannullis, the number two seed, finishing up her practice shots here on the championship round pair. And as we mentioned, Carol Giannotti ended up in the number seven position. She had to fill in and bowl for Donna Adamek, who was unable to go.
Well, Donna was having a little problem also with the approaches, and she re-pulled the muscle that we have been talking about in her past few telecasts that she had injured. And she wanted to be ready up for the next 2 weeks, but she just said, hey, I'll withdraw and Carol can go in for me and finish quite well.
So Nikki Giannullis now has opted for her starting lane, so Leanne Barrett will get the start here in game number three, the semifinal game. And she'll begin preparation for a shot on lane 25. She has a 50-pin victory to her credit over Lisa Wagner in game two, 227 to 177.
I think the key here, Denny, is Leanne is comfortable with this pair. She has hit the pocket in a high percentage left in and comes right out and hits it again. So the shot looks good for Leanne.
Well, if you check her program stats, normally when she gets lined up in a television round pair, she's going to hit the pocket time after time. So I'm sure that Nikki is very well aware of that, although in practice, Nikki had a pretty good shot as well.
Nikki coming off a second-place finish last week. Feels right on top of her game.
The top seed in this one, Alita Phil from Dearborn, Michigan. Waiting in the wings. Loosening up a little bit, getting prepared for the one-game match. And, boy, you have to look at this player here and wonder when, oh, when will she win a title on television?
Well, I asked her about last week, and I don't think it was the mental pressure of being in that number one position. She said she came out, and she just felt like she couldn't hang on to the ball, or she put tape in it, then she would hang up. So the humidity was really bothering her last week, especially on the show with the lights on.
Comes out and rips the rack on the right-hand lane, so she opens up with a strike. And basically, though, if you look at the numbers, she is 3-11 from the top seed position. She has not won on television in her last 21 appearances. So those are some staggering numbers when you think how difficult it is to get to the telecast, and she's done it for the eighth time this year.
And she almost captured the number one position here last night. So.
Yeah, I think she was 59 pins down going into the final game against Alita, so she'd have had to bowl a big game to get there. But and right now she's waiting on her ball. On lane 26.
Nikki, age 29. This is her 11th year on tour. She enjoys sailing and also tennis. Plays a lot of tennis.
And the last thing you need right now is, after you throw a strike, to wait for the bowling ball, and we're all waiting with tremendous anticipation for that thing to pop out. So it seems like it's always one thing or another as far as Nikki is concerned. Now, both of them come back, so she got two for the price of one.
Oh, right. I don't think Leanne's going to give up hers, though. Nikki looking for a double to start the match off. Especially after that little bit of a break, she has to feel like, hey, are things going to go my way anytime soon? So really an excellent shot there. Good concentration.
Overdue for a couple of breaks is Nikki Giannoulias. And both players starting to warm up here on the championship round pair.
I was reading Leanne's bio earlier, and I had to laugh because one of her hobbies was watching Joe Montana throw touchdowns for the Niners. She said Joe Montana's her guy, so she enjoys watching him throw touchdowns.
Sure, he probably enjoys watching her throw strikes as well.
Well, if he's tuned in, he would.
Well, sure. What else would he be doing this evening?
A terrible break. Solid 7-pin. Don't see that too often, Denny, by a right-hander.
And there you see the little tweak of the nose. Not real crazy about that break either.
No.
That kills you. You throw your best shot and you leave the solid 7.
The 4-pin supposed to take out that 7-pin. Looked like it flew right in front of it and over it and around it. It didn't hit it.
I guess there is a penalty for throwing it too well and having the ball hit too hard, but I think I'd rather be in that position than the other side of the spectrum.
You bet.
Which is where I normally was throughout my career.
That's why you're in television, right? Showbiz.
So I'm told, yeah. Solid year thus far. Obviously much better than last.
Well, Nikki coming out in 1979, bowler Rookie of the Year, and in 1982 she was the Bowling Writer Women Bowler of the Year, so she's had a really great career.
Pulls this shot badly and leaves herself with a problem here in the third.
And Nikki, a four-step approach bowler, gets the ball pushed away on her first step. You can see here she wears the arm support, the wrist supports to keep her wrist in that straight position, long knee bend, good follow through, and very square and up, almost upright at the line. That's the force of her follow through that pulls her up.
Good leverage player, and you have to have leverage to pick up the spare that she just did, the 3-6-9-10. Both players very deliberate, and we are, I think, running a little behind here, so bear with us. We might have to bowl through a couple more commercials in order to get everything in on time.
Well, Leanne, a player that does like to take her time. Also, Nikki.
Now, one thing is for sure, they know how to throw strikes when they get loosened up. So a good match here in the semifinal. Leanne Barrett leads by six. We'll be back with more right after this. The nose, Leanne Barrett takes the six right off the ten.
This you don't like to see to happen because you think that you actually covered the spare, and boom, just chop that right off as clean as could be.
Well, they tell you if you take the lead pin, you normally will pick up the spare, but it's obviously best to touch all the pins with the ball, then you know they're going down.
This is about the biggest break Nikki Giannoulias has received in a long time, as we mentioned. A solid seven in the third frame for Leanne, a chop in the fourth, and back on it, as we say, in the fifth.
Well, Leanne's mistake has been setting the ball a little shorter left. It seems when she does swing the ball, she hits the pocket with every shot. Easy to notice that from up here, though. She probably thinks she's swinging the ball when she's really not. Nikki Giannoulias works on a strike in the fourth. Could take a 29-pin lead if she strikes here.
Coming up high, last time only 26.
Did not trust it, did not swing it right. So the right-hand lane, obviously, is much tighter than the left because the ladies are not giving it any room.
Nikki, another player that likes to cross boards, but she's able to project the ball speed and go pretty straight for a player that opens up as much as she does as well.
Very talented. She can go straight with it, medium, or really hook the thing right off the lane, and that's why she has 10 titles to her credit. Don't get that many without being very versatile, is she? Tries now to pick up the baby split. She sticks it in there like a glove.
Perfect conversion as John Wonders looks on.
Yeah, the president of Fabball Incorporated. Dennis Baldwin to the left, of course, the proprietor here and president of Fabball Maryland. And to his right, another outstanding individual, Dave Hardy, president of Fabball Utah.
We're surrounded by a lot of presidents.
Mm-hmm. Well, this one explodes the pins on the left-hand lane. So the players who have solved the puzzle of the right-hand lane this evening have been the ones with the victories. For the viewers at home, you know, so many times the lanes look exactly the same. They look like they're hooking about the same, but there can be tremendous difference.
Well, there were a few characteristics this week throughout the pairs that we hit. I found the right lane cooking a little bit more than the left lanes in this particular instance. As we mentioned, the right lane's tighter, so certain pairs have certain characteristics. That's why we see the television averages so different on pairs. One player may be extremely low, another player extremely high. Take a look at this shot as she flushes this strike for the double. See where she sets the ball. Right around the 12th board, coming out to about the 9th board. That ball didn't really swing out as far, pretty straight on line for Leanne. You can see the reaction of all the pins. The head pin going off the wall and kicking out that 7.
So that was the double. If she strikes here, she takes the lead by 1. This has been her good lane. And she throws an excellent shot. So while we depart here, Leanne Barrett has taken a 1-10 lead. We'll be back with a conclusion from Baltimore, Maryland, right after. And we're back live after a clutch strike. Is it a three-bagger? No, the solid 10 here in the eighth.
Figuring out lane 26 for the double here. Nikki stays right in it. The ball stays pretty straight on line. Not a lot of belly. Coming back just at the last minute. And flush strike, as we say. And last shot looked pretty good, too, on lane 25 as she left the ringing 10.
It was a key shot in the seventh. She needed to double up to kind of keep pace with Lee Ann. That one better stay on the lane. Just does. So Nikki with a spare in the eighth. As we approach the latter stages here of the semifinal game, next in line, the top seed, Alita Sill of Dearborn, Michigan.
Leanne looking for one more strike right now to keep her within pins of Nikki Jr. Lee. She's now minus eight. Plenty of room, but not a lot of ball speed. I think she realized she let up on it and was going to hook in. She kind of waved it. And
it appears as if the ball will come back on the right hand.
She should do that, hitting high. Yes, it does. The players that have got it out there a few times, Lisa Wagner went a little right with it, and it hooked. Can be worse if you throw it right and know it's not going to be coming back, or throw it right and know it's going to hook too much on you.
The fine tuning, as they say, on the championship round pair.
And that's what it's all about.
First one to figure them out normally wins. Leanne trailing by nine.
The big strike here in the ninth frame.
Possible 226 for Leanne if she would strike out. 235, the best score for Nikki G. Another shot in the pocket leaves another solid four, so Leanne has basically drilled the old 1-3, but has only one double in this game to show for it.
Well, the seventh pin falls, that gives her a double, and the two fours right there could have given her a five-bagger. Lanes could be changing a little bit for Leanne, breaking down a little bit more.
Well, you know they probably are. That's generally the characteristic. The other thing people don't realize at home, the professionals are constantly moving with their feet and their target a little bit and changing ball speeds to try and keep the ball in the pocket.
They change from the time you start practicing to NHL, the time the games are over.
Yeah, many times you start with a ball in practice that works well, and you get up to throw your four shots right before the show, and it's not even close. Nikki Giannoulias in a golden opportunity position right now to just grab the semifinal game. The messenger strike in the night, a break that she has been waiting for.
I think she probably thought this 7-10 is going to stand. As you can see here, just a great shot. The 5-pin going in front of the 7. The head of it hit it. Here comes the head pin to take out the 10.
Well, did you see the head pin hit the 5-2 and kind of push it into the 7? Leanne saw it all the way and didn't care much for it. Well, Leanne's best score would be 215, so a strike right here puts Nikki Giannoulias in the position to move on to the championship game. Oh boy, couldn't throw it much better, but we have a possibility of a tie here in the semifinal game with a spare strike. It would be 215 for Nikki G, and if Leanne would strike out, she would shoot 215.
We thought in the first game, Stacy Ryder needing three strikes to win the match.
If got Nikki, two and it's close.
If Nikki spares and strikes, Leanne will need all three.
All right, so first things first. Time to regroup now and throw the strike.
Leanne clutching her grip right tight bag. Really concentrating. It looks like she's probably watching exactly what Nikki's doing, but it's a form of concentration here.
Kind of shrugs her shoulders and says, I guess you got to expect that once in a while.
Like you said, definitely yanked it. Hit inside her target, the ball hooking, and got the break by it going left. Five pin falling backwards, and this is her reaction. Okay, I'll take it.
All right, so three strikes, and we have a tie here in the semifinal game.
Fouled on that shot, Denny.
Well, off comes the glove. Not happy with that at all. Leanne Barrett fouls and just gives it away to Nikki G.
Now, with the long slide that she has, a player that has fouled actually three or four times during this tournament, got to the line ahead of the ball, fouled us, just finishing out the match. We can try to take a look at her foot over the line. You can see just about a half an inch there of the line.
So a critical error for Leanne Barrett, who loses 215 to 182. We're down to the final two. Nikki Giannoulias in the top seed, Alita Sill, when we return to Baltimore. And let's take a look at the finalist by round now. Alita Sill started 11th, kind of worked her way up, and then held on to the top spot.
You can see a look at Nikki's performance. She's right up there pretty much the whole tournament.
Never lower than 6th, and now she has an opportunity to snap a long string. She has made 21 appearances without a victory, and with Alita Sill right in front of her right now, it won't be an easy road.
Leanne Barrett asked me to mention that a fan of hers, Gene, at home is very ill, and she wanted to let him know that her thoughts and prayers are with him, and wanted to get that in before we get too far into this match.
Okay. Opening shot, championship game. Fifth of the four to start things off.
I think Nikki's feeling very comfortable here tonight versus last week when we mentioned her hand going up and down with the humidity. So I think that's the key for her. She says, hey, if it's going to happen, it's going to happen. And another lady that feels the same way is Alita Sill.
That doesn't seem to let much bother her.
Now, as you can see, Alita's game. She actually has that crook in her elbow when she comes through, but good knee bend. And like I said, very methodical. She had a little bit of a wrist injury, tendonitis, earlier this year, and she's been babying it, had to take a few weeks off. She says it feels great right now.
Had that wrist in a cast for about 3 weeks. Plenty of extra roll on that shot as she leaves the 8 count. And told me too, Leila, that she's basically gone from a 16-pound ball to a 15-pound ball to kind of help the tendonitis along.
Making a big difference. I did that. I had tendonitis in my elbow at one point a few years back. I dropped from 16-pound to 15-pound ball. A lot of the women on tour do throw 16-pound bowling balls, and there are a lot out here that throw 15-pound bowling balls.
And then there's obviously a difference on some conditions as far as pin carry is concerned. Alita said that this week she didn't have much problem at all with pin carry, as she obviously gets away with a close shave here in the second.
A very unusual way to pick up this spare here.
Well, there's nothing like watching a little trick shooting as well in the championship round.
That's exactly what that was. And a big smile from Alita as she walked back and knew she picked that up by the hair on her chinny chin chin.
For the championship round, Perry, she starts with a double.
Coming out a little bit more aggressively now on lane 26, giving it the room, the ball making the break back.
Oh, Career-wise, Nikki, 1-3 against Alita Sill. As a matter of fact, Alita defeated her in her first ever appearance in the championship round and won her first title.
That was in 1981 at the Galaxy of Homes Open in Los Angeles. And I believe that bowling center is no longer there either.
Kind of tough to go back and defend.
That's right.
So Nikki Giannulli is with a hot hand in the championship game, starts with the first three.
Nikki maybe feeling this is her opportunity right here. Lane 25, her good lane. You've got to hit your good lane. Just crunches the pocket. She say, come on, baby. Is she, Carrie.
And on the other side of the coin, not going to get the job done with the head pin. Alita still hits the pocket and ends up with a seventh pin. 8 wins and 6 losses from the top seed position. She shares the most victories from the top seed with Lisa Wagner, who has also won 8 times, but has started 17 times from the top seed position. A cool customer to Alita Sill.
At 27 years of age.
15 titles. Average on the television pair this week, 220. And then you see shaking her head a little bit. Obviously wanting to get something started here quickly.
She's used to getting them started quickly, Denny. You've seen her come many times and just throw the first 5 or 6 in a row.
Yeah, you're right about that. She makes good shots and usually gets ahead. Finds herself trailing here, though, in the championship game by 21 pins.
Nikki looking to keep the string going. Started out with 3 in a row. Her tournament high game, 280. Kim Terrell also shot 300 this week, Denny, along with Leanne Barrett.
Mm-hmm.
Get a 10 times 26. The 6 in just in the channel, though. So she did give it the room. It didn't quite make it back with enough force to cause the 6 to get the 10 out.
26 is the tricky lane. You have to throw good shots or you don't get strength.
It looks like even if you do throw a pretty good shot, you might not get it. So it is in the tricky lane here this evening.
At this point, just stay ahead, keep hitting the pocket, and force the top seed, Alita Sill, to come back. Alita working on a strike in the fourth, as you see graphically how close this one is thus far. Anytime you got that strike up and you get a chance to come up with turkey, you're right in the thick of the match.
Want to get the lead quick, too, Denny. These games go very, very fast. Get a jump on your opponent. A little high, leaving the four pin. Seen a lot of four pins tonight. Backhands are finishing very good. Leaves the left. You see the lane, the ball takes and dives very sharply to the left.
I watched Alita Sill that time. Didn't pay attention to the shot from Giannulis, and Alita looked down at the floor the whole time. Did not want to see what was happening. Differential between Nikki Giannulis in the blue and the lady in red, Alita Sill. Alita with a career television match play record of 41-35 thus far this year. In 89, she's won 8 times and lost 5.
She's been able to capture 1 title this year, and that was in her hometown of Detroit, a very special title for her.
Trying to double up, and she does. Kicks that 7-10 out, and now it's just a 9-10 match.
Once again, our low angle, as you can see. Stays with the shot, good leverage, and good result.
4-pin at the last moment, taking out the 7. Strike here, and she leads by 1.
Was look like it was going to make it.
Active head pin, but it didn't quite get to the seven. Goes to the harder, shinier equipment for the cross lane spare conversion.
Alita enjoying golf. She's still fishing in her time off, so she likes to relax.
Good look at our vantage point. Of course, we do have plexiglass in front of us, and the players do not really ever hear what we're saying. Don't want to disturb them while they're on the approach.
No, it's very important that you don't hear really any sounds, unusual sounds, and doors slamming, things like that when you're trying to concentrate.
Good speed, tough break. Solid 10. Second time in a row she's left the 10 pin on lane 26, and she's got a pretty good feel for the lane. She just can't knock them down.
That's right. Lane 26, a tough lane. We've talked about it all night. A little flat on her last attempt. She made the adjustment, and now leaving a ringing 10. So it's just a matter if she can carry.
Nikki posted the high average throughout the tournament on the championship round pair. Now you saw it, 228. Picks up the 10-10 one more time. Falling with a lot of confidence right now.
She is. She looks like she's confident. She feels good. However, she's just saying, hey, like to carry. I've hit the pocket now six times in a row and left two 10s and a 4.
And she might be seeing 10-pins in the rack as she goes for the re-rack on lane 25.
Players are allowed one re-rack during their match. If any others are requested, Tournament Director Fran Wolf will step in and decide whether it's awarded or not.
Old eagle eyes. Really getting out of the ball clean right now, and she kind of cleans things in a little bit and strikes in the seven.
Well, they say what goes around comes around, and she did get the break here as the ball hitting high. And she got out of a big split here, Denny. She had the big four standing at one time, and the 4-10, the last to go.
Then it was adios to the rest of the crew. Big break there in the seventh. Trailing by nine now, and shooting in the seventh. Plenty of room. This one comes charging back, and Alita still now. She trails by nine, could recapture the lead, and she strikes in the eighth.
Take a look at actually Alita's line where she's playing off the left side. Really between the first and second arrow, right around the fifth, sixth board.
Well, you love to see that ball roll all the way through to the pit. I think it's just turning over label after label.
Left-handers usually with a natural forward roll.
Ooh, both players have just throttled the pocket here in the championship game, and other than a couple of doubles and one turkey, there haven't been many strikes.
Alita only missing the pocket one time, Nikki not missing the pocket. We could have had all strikes, Denny.
Mm-hmm.
But what?
No problem with the seven, and both players just kind of going back and forth. That's what we're going to see, I think. A very crucial 10th frame, and what better way to wrap up the $40,000 Hammer Eastern Open and have it come down to one frame.
Well, you see a lot of times, Denny, on higher scoring conditions, that it does just come down to who can carry. And you can adjust your carry by your ball speeds, by the weights and the balls, and the players are always trying to find that magic ball that will carry the best for.
Trying for the double. This with more room, and just a slash-o-matic shot, and a kind of a funny shot. She left the pin.
Really blowing out the pins that time, throwing everything left except the sixth pin, just went for the channel. Didn't take out that pin.
Stacy Ryder finished fifth, Lisa Wagner fourth, Leanne Barrett in the number three position, and we're down to two out of 100 players that started the week here in Baltimore.
We're seeing more and more players coming out bowling, especially this fall. Great prize money, good tournament.
And of course, it's live on ESPN. This one's pretty much been the scenario of the way they qualified here this evening. Each higher qualifier has won the match, so if that holds true, Elita's Hill will have victory number 16. I'm not so sure that's going to happen here tonight.
That's right. She's trailing by nine. Nikki Janulis up in the ninth frame. A key shot right here. If she gets this, there's no way Elita could lock her out.
And if she strikes here and we take it off the sheet, she could shoot 237. That's more than enough to win. The best score Elita could post would be 228. Stretches out nicely, needs the break, and doesn't get it. Leaves the 10 pin. So it's one shot after another in the pocket, and Elita quickly up to look at the scoreboard, realizing, hey, I can win now. If I go up and throw three strikes, I can win this match. And that's all you can ever hope for.
That's right. We saw Stacy Ryder hoping for it, just to get up, throw three strikes. Leanne Barrett, throw three strikes to tie. We've got some very good matches tonight.
Competitive all the way down the line. A little ooing and eyeing, and I'm going to join the crowd there. I didn't think that was going to stay on the lane.
I didn't either, to tell you the truth. I think I was going to ooh and ah on that one.
Okay, very simply put right now, Elita Sill is in a position to take this one and notch career victory number 16. She needs three strikes in order to do so. Good ball speed. Oh boy, another solid seven. So this one's going right down to the bitter end.
Both players are going to take this tape home and look at it and go, hey, any one of these shots could have gone. Watch the four pin here. Just ringing around the seven. And her reaction, like, come on. She knew she threw a good ball.
All right, enough of the seven pin. So now 217 would be her top score. And now Nikki Giannoulias, if she would double, could win the championship. Back and forth, Leila.
Wanting to post all three strikes.
Fans calling for it to get up, get up. Nick sure did giddy up right into the pocket, so she's got the first one, a possible 217 if she strikes out.
If she strikes out, she does force Nikki to get two strikes and to stay behind the line.
And you don't have to be a mathematician to realize what she needs. Key shot right here, though.
Elita not taking a lot of time.
Oh, a quick shot for Elita Sill, who strikes in the 11th. So one more, and it's 217, but she does force the double.
Hitting a little lighter in the pocket, carrying the wall shot, as we say. Carried better than the 7 pin.
Ooh, look at the eyes there, huh?
One more count is very important here. One strike forces Nikki to get two.
One more to kind of finish things off. That one was right at the target, but she strikes out. And so it's a game of 217 coming up immediately following Nikki Giannoulias' shot here in the 10th.